Good morning. In the last lecture, we have discussed a lot about various types of energy of Vedic science, and Vedic scientists had practiced and used it in their period. And subsequently, we discussed how the modern scientist made an effort, modern scientists like Tesla, Newton, and others, contemporaries, made an effort based on the influence of Vivekananda, how the free energy can be available abundantly in the space, can be converted into usable energy in the ground, For that, Tesla came out with the clue of Vedic science, the Tesla coil. And we know that he went to J.P. Morgan for the funding of the project to start an industry. But since they have already funded millions of dollars to the electrical industries, which are manufacturing motor, transformer, and the transmission system, etc., and they all came to know about this development and then approached J.P. Morgan, look, if you give your money to Tesla and we have to close our industry, we'll not be able to give you any fund, whatever the loan you have given, we'll not be able to refund you. So whole our industry will collapse. So then J.P. Morgan told Tesla, sorry, we cannot give it. And there is the end of it. But I had also presented Tesla's co-scientist, well, documented this in the form of paper. He said, this is a technology from beast. Nobody can stop it. One day or other, it becomes reality. And that east means that is in India. It's an ancient Indian technology. It has to be, it will become reality one day or other. So there is a way I had stopped. Now I would like to continue further, because I spoke about various forms of energy, energy conservation, and little bit of, I'll speak about energy management, ancient management system, then come to the three case studies, which engineers of our time dedicated themselves and made re-engineering of the ancient science in the field of energy. So I will share my slides. So hope you will be able to read, and I'll start my lecture. This is where we had stopped last time. The free energy devices proposed by Tesla based on the concept of Vedic science would have revolutionized the socio-economic status quo on a planet Earth if we had support to develop basic free energy science into a usable technology. So electrical power would have been available any part of the globe abundantly, but according to Tobey, he was not allowed by denying the financial support for the project by the vested interest, which I explained to you earlier. So what it indicates from this literature is that ancient races were knowing how to generate abundant energy and power. The present day scientist and scholars needs to re-engineer this lost science. This is where we had stopped, and we will continue further on this. We'll slightly look at into earlier we discussed on solar energy, the part of the energy systems used in aircraft. But here, the ancient races also had a knowledge of converting solar energy into the vital energy for survival of the mankind. This is what it's, that's you know, concept of Surya Yoga. And here, person can draw energy directly from the sun rays, like a plants, and this energy can be substituted to the a normal food itself. This is something revolutionary system. Which so Surya Yoga also says that by doing a Surya Yoga every day, the Panch Bhutas, that is Agni, Earth, Ether, Air, and Water, of this body and controlling seven chakras. See, energy we are getting from this body is from Shat Chakra, seven chakras which are located in this body. One can reach Adhyatmik Shanti at the Paramoksha stage, that is eternal peace. Probably this technique was used by ancient rishis when they were doing a long tapasya in Himalayan region. In fact, I just wanted to share my own experience when I was in Himalaya for a couple of months, a few years back. And I had come across with one of such yogis. He was claiming that he was about 150 years old, and I could see only a skeleton on his body. And deep into the interior, even during the snow, when there is whole thing full of snow, still he used to be there in Himalaya and survive. Perhaps, I don't know, probably this be the kind of technology he might have been using it. The conservation of energy was well known to Vedic scientists, as I highlighted in earlier. Devices like hydraulic accumulator, electrical accumulator were used in many sophisticated yantras and astras for storage of a conservation of energy. Vedic literature also mentioned the kind of management system required for management of the various energies and astras made by using a principle of various energies discussed so far. Atharvaveda chapter 7.12.2 says, O member of the council, I know the nature of the power, since you are called Narishta, whose orders have to Narishta, is the king, supreme king, whose orders are bound to be obeyed. People shall obey your order. All the members of this council have to work collectively. This shows that to manage the strategic energies like nuclear energy, anti-gravity energy, mercury propulsion, etc., they formed a council which controls and regulates the usage of these energy for defense and peaceful applications. Probably we can correlate to the similar Indian government body like a National Security Advisory Board. Another example of Vedic energy management system is, as we have come across earlier, Emperor Ashoka, a secret society of the nine unknown men highlighted earlier. So before I go to the case studies, I would like to just conclude so far whatever I have been presented based on my own studies and literature references. In this lecture, overview of ancient Vedic science related to energy conversion, conservation, application, and to some extent management approach has been presented and discussed. This literature review indicates beyond doubt that knowledge of various sources of energy, including advanced energy and related technology like atomic energy, solar energy, plasma energy, mercury vapor propulsion energy, etc., were well known to the Vedic scientists, and they had successfully employed these energy concepts in various vimanas, yantras, as well as weapons. New concept of free energy physics and subtle energy were also discussed. Observed a lot of contradiction with the modern science. However, further research and deep studies are required to understand these concepts very clearly for the present day application. Although NASA and Chinese space agencies are pursuing the research on anti-gravity as well as mercury vortex propulsion system and other related energy system, but unfortunately, Indian scientific community appears to be not taken seriously to pursue further research in this area. In order to pursue the research in this area, the scientists, Sanskrit scholars, philosophers, and historians shall make a serious effort to trace the original Sanskrit scripture containing these ancient strategic science, which is very relevant to the present-day needs of a country. Now I would like to come to the case studies. I present three case studies. One case study is based on Vedas. Another case study is based on Sankhya. And third case study is based on Vaimanika Shastra. It is quite encouraging that couple of our modern scientists and engineers are fascinated by ancient technology which is hidden in the Sanskrit literature, sutras, and they dedicated their life, some of them dedicate their life for re-engineering of this. One of such person is Sri H.R. Satish Chandra. I would like to give, I was in association with him long time back when I was a senior scientist in DRDO, particularly in a gas turbine establishment in a propulsion system of aircraft engine. I came in contact with him, and at that time I was introduced to the Vedic science by the earlier pontiff of Sripad Yelmut, Vijnanadithi Thiru. He motivated me to take this ancient science seriously. So since I was working in the domain of aerospace, I'm more concentrated on Vaimanika Shastra and aerospace material. But when I heard about Satish Chandra has done fantastic re-engineering and research work based on a Purush Sukta, I was fascinated. Then I went to his lab a couple of times, interacted with him, and witnessed what he has done. Is something remarkable, I thought. He had permitted me to share his work when the National Institute of Vedic Science had conducted one of the national conference on ancient energy systems. In that, I had invited him to come and present, but due to some other commitment, he could not come. Then he had permitted me to present his work in that conference. So I'm utilizing that and for the wider reaching to the wider people, I'm choosing this forum to present that once again here. As a preamble, let me give the background of Mr. Satish Chandra. He is a professionally qualified electrical engineer, great researcher of Vedic science, has done extensive research from more than three decades on Purush Sukta to derive an Adibhautika explanation which gives an alternative meaning to Purush Sukta as a electrical engineering. He has written a book on that. Sri H.R. Satish Chandra, he hails from the traditional, cultured and philanthropic family from Hebbale, that is a village in Hasan district of Karnataka. And he did his Bachelor of Engineering, Electrical Engineering from Hasan Engineering College, and further M.Tech in Electrical Engineering from Indian Institute of Science. Initially worked as an Assistant Executive Engineer in Orissa Electricity Board, then migrated to Canada and USA. There he established his own power companies. He came back to India to do research on Purush Sukta and set up various educational research institutions. After his detailed many decades of research on Purush Sukta, he developed Agrigami Nature's electricity generating system. So I would like to share some of the incident which made him to motivate to work on this. To me, probably that may inspire others. When he had come from USA in one of the vacation, he is a strong follower of Sringeri Shankaracharya Math. He, along with his mother or family, he had been to every time he goes to meet the Swamiji. He met him and Swamiji learned about his achievement. He just asked him, Satish Chandra, you have done so much of work on electrical engineering, power generation, so much in USA and Canada and doing a lot. But what have you done to this country? Do you know? Our Vedic scripture contains all this information. Why didn't you look something on this? Probably that was the time, you know, such a great tapasvi of Sringeri Swamiji, when he so told this to him, it simply penetrated deeper into his mind. He didn't go back at all. Then he gave a clue. I heard about that Purushukta is so powerful mantra, Vedic mantra. Of course, we all use it for doing Abhisheka to Lord. But this Adibhautikava, it has contains a tremendous understanding, may have a solution to the energy. He was so fascinated, he took a deeper studies, but then he didn't know how to go about it. Then understand that typically everybody, like every sadhaka, looks at the Himalaya. So that's how he went to Himalaya, wandered, talked to many of those great adhyatmic gurus, sadhakas, but they all laughed at him. What are you talking about? Purushukta is for adhyatmic sadhana. We chant it for to get the blessings of the Lord. And you say it is electricity or it is a power. Oh, you are mad. Then he came in contact with the Sringeris. I mean, he came in contact with the Shankaracharya of Allahabad. And Allahabad Shankaracharya was well known in his contribution in the Adibhautika aspect of the Vedas. He is the one who had done a good lot of work on Vedic mathematics. He came in contact with him, sought his guidance. He said, yes, true. It contains. But I don't know. But I can tell you how to decode. Only way to decode is how the rishis have done it. Rishis became a drastaras. Rishis created own laboratory in a mind and tested that whatever is came to their mind. That is only possible. How they got it? It is basically from the Almighty, who created, who is the nature by itself. He is a creator. He is a Purusha. He knows that. And with his blessings only, you can decode this. Only way is do tapasya. Do deeper meditation. Think of what you want to for the answer. And meditate upon that. Longer I was. Teach a samadhi, probably Lord will bless you and give you the answer what you are seeking for it. This penetrated deeper into his mind, came back to India. Then he wanted to set up something at the academic institution to have a ground for him to do such kind of work. Then he purchased, I understand, the running education institute, a Rama school or something near Jakur, which I had been there, and then pursued that deeper, meditate, very long meditation to reach the samadhi stage. Each word by word started meditating, and in the state of meditation he started getting the signals. Those signals he started recording it, and then he is being electrical engineer. Probably it would have been just a Sanskrit scholar, it would have been difficult. But he is being an electrical engineer. He could able to correlate those signals into the modern science and came out the excellent interpretation, meaning Adibhautika, meaning every word of the Purushottama, and then correlated that into the actual working model and built his own a prototype to proof of concept. So this is kind of a background. For that, it is not possible ordinary man. He has to dedicate. He simply dedicated his life for this. To do the deeper meditation, dhyana, and then during that meditation, samadhi state, getting a signal, and that is decoding into the equivalent to the power system, which is something, no, it is not normal human being. It's difficult unless he surrender himself to the Almighty and to get his kripa or his blessings. So this is information which I shared here, because in my personal interaction with him, he had told me. I thought why I shared it is basically it may motivate some youngsters to take this line of Vedic science a little more seriously and pursue it. That's what I had done. I happened to visit his institution and laboratory in Bangalore. Long way back, that is on 6 February 2005. And I had a detailed discussion on the subject, and he also demonstrated the yantra developed by him as per the directive of Purusha Sukta, which generates 3 to 6 times the higher electrical energy than a conventional alternators. He has developed 2 machines. One is bring the, that is ultimate solution perhaps, is the free energy what is available in the space, the earth. Another one is developing an alternator which will multiply the input energy, will multiply and give an as an output, which is impossible in a modern science. Whatever in a generator, whatever the power I give it, and there is always a loss. So what I get an output is less than input. So here it is other way around. So I was fascinated by the great research done by him and requested him to attend the conference at that time in 2005, as I briefed you already on that, and which made me present his work. Then in his book, as a preface to the book, Satyachandra says, Purusha Sukta has been explained in 16 slokas in Rig Veda and Sam Veda, in 18 slokas in Krishna Yajurveda, also known as Purva Narayanam. Another 6 slokas in a Krishna Yajurveda is known as a Uttara Narayanam. Narayanam is nothing but a galaxy of nerves interconnected in a unique fashion. This has also been explained in Atharvana Veda and 7 Chandasa also. He also says that a Purusha Sukta can be understood in 3 ways, namely mantra, the formula, a skeletal explanation of the text. Second is yantra, the design, structure and materials to be used in the devices. Third one is tantra, that is a technique and secret of internal mechanism for operating the said devices. As dedicated in the 16th sloka in Rig Veda and 18th sloka in Krishna Yajurveda, the sadhaka who want to understand the secrets of this omnipotent energy to do so when Navarandras and Panchendriyas are synchronized when under the deep meditation. This is an underline. Navarandras, this body has got 9 gateways, and Panchendriyas are synchronized when under the deep meditation. He should disper each alpha bit in 45 ways. And he says, to the best of my knowledge, the 18 slokas in Krishna Yajurveda, which is known as Purva Narayanam, is for generating electricity. And 6 slokas known as Uttara Narayanam relates to a nuclear physics. A combined study of these 24 slokas and whispering in the earnest way will take the pride of Mother India to the highest esteem. And the whole world will look towards the Mother India and Vedas for that expert eminence. Mr. Satyachandra also mentioned that when we entered deep into this sukta, it explains in detail in a quoted words. Why? That is to maintain the secrecy. Detailed explanation of the text, that's one, and detailed design, and details of the technical procedure to generate electricity in 6 ways. What are the 6 ways? One is Chandra, Surya, Indra, Agni, Prana, and Vayu, in par with the 6 conventional ways of generating electricity in a modern science, namely hydroelectrical energy, solar energy, chemical energy, thermal energy, and atomic and windmill energy. This is what exactly it indicates. It is amazing to note that details of the explanation, design, and technical know-how can be derived by the dispersing the 657 alphabets contained in this mantra itself. This shows the excellence, abundant knowledge, and superiority that our ancestor possessed it. Now let me come to the Purushottam itself. I hope you are able to see the slide. Here, every word by word, the meaning he has given, what he derived in his deeper samadhi state. The original Purushottam is called Purushat Suptam. It is not Purush Supta, it is a Purushat Suptam. That is what Satish Chandra has drawn following meaning for this. Purushaha, that is man, and that is man symbolizes of the energy. Shat means 6 types. Shat means 6. So there are 6 types. Su is an appropriate statement. 6 type of appropriate statement. It means Su Upta. Su Upta. If you do the Sandhi, Su and Upta. That's what it. Upta means say. Give a statement. Purushutra start with Sahasra Sirishaha Purushaha Sahasracha Sahasrapat Sabhumim Ishvato Virvatpat Atishta Dashangulam. See, this is what we normally chant, who regularly worship. But what it says that, he says Sahasra Sirishaha Sahasrachaha. That is Sahasrachaha, innumerable positive, Asankhyada Dhanyatmaka. See, so beautifully he has done it. In fact, he has given in Hindi, he has given in English, as well as in local language of Kannada. Sahasrapat, that is Asankhyat, that is innumerable negative, innumerable positive, Sahasracha, Sahasrapat, innumerable negative, that is Asankhyat Runatmaka in Kannada, and Sirshaha. Sirsha means bits of energy, that is a pieces, shiktiya tunukugalu, bits of energy. Bhumim, that is, Bhumim means Bhumandalam. Bhumandalam where? Where in Bhumandalam, where it? It is in lithosphere, in the space. Lithosphere in the space, it contains innumerable positive and negative energy pieces. Purushaha, then is the whole universe, that is entire Brahmanda. Auratvaha, that is engulfed in the whole universe from all the sides. From all sides, this energy is engulfed in the whole universe. Saha, that means Satcha, that means Antaha. Sahasra Sirshaha, 1000 bits of energy are taken. Meaning, summary meaning of this sloka is numerous positive and negative charges has engulfed in the lithosphere and universe from all the sides. If thousands of such pieces are harnessed in a gazette having 10 divisions and made to stand in 10 inches it becomes energy, it becomes electricity. So precisely, it's decoded. Now, sloka number 2. Purusha evadam sarvam yadbhutam yachchabhavam utamrata sveshana yadanyena shirohati. It says here, summary, the energy this generated was used in the past, being used in the present, and should be used in the future also. And this will be like a nectar in the whole world, because this is a better items available in this whole world. Third sloka, eta vanasya mahimato jayasya purushaha. Padosya Vishwabhudani Tripadda Sambratam Divihi. This is the greatness of this energy. Amazing. Supermost important to this creation only. One quarter of this energy thus generated will be more than sufficient for this whole world. Rest 3/4 will remain unused in the heaven, that is the upper part of this universe. This is what this interpretation of the sloka. Then sloka 4, Tribha Udaitu Rushaha Padoseha Bhavatvanaha Tato Vishvatvakya Tato Vishvatvakamat Shanashane Abhihim. This 3-phase energy can be stepped up or stepped down and will be alternative current. Only 1/4 of this energy is being consumed by the living or non-living, those who consume food or not, and in various forms of this world. Let us look at the sloka 5. Tasmadirala jayatah vishato adipurushah sa jato atyarachata paschad bhumi matho purah. That energy can be developed to the highest order, that is extra high voltage, and from this extra high voltage other form of energy was created. Immediately it took various forms like heat, light, sound, motive, etc., and mobile and static forms of alloys of 7 metals were created. Yat purushena havishah deva yadya matanvatah vasanto asya asvasanto asya dajyam grishmam idam sharadavihi. When sadhaka has taken vow to venture to know the secrets of generating the energy, they visualized hydrocarbon or oil, fats, firewood, coal, naphtha and plasma as a fuel to be used for this kind of a generation. Tam yajnaha bairshi prauchanan purusham jatam agratah tena deva ayajanta sadhyah rushascha ke. As stated above, this energy was collected by the sadhaka or rishi who has understood the secret of this energy by touching the energy by means of dharma spread over the yajna mantapa. How it correlates the rituals.
Tasmadajnatsavarvanhutah samratam shadajyam pushunam taschankre vaya vavyanarayan vananaranyan gramaschayem.
As described earlier, through the generation of this omnipotent energy, they developed a technique to replace oil, ghee, that is using the energy for running the machinery and for the light. People living in urban areas started using this energy for transportation through air, land and water. So beautifully it gives. So I'll explain. Stotra is very clearly visible to you. And read the, I will explain more of summary of this. as previously explained in this ninth sloka, it says summary, as previously explained, the details of the generation of this omnipotent energy has been explained in Rigveda, Samveda, and seven Chandasa, and also has been explained in detail in Krishna Yajurveda. This sloka decodes and gives the further where it is available. So here, this one, tasmadasya jayanta eke cho bhayadatah gavo jadnire tasmat jata jayava ajavayaham. What it says, what is this generated energy should be called? As known as what it should be called? It is known as a horsepower. It is known as a horsepower. In the same way, they have called it a cow, goat, and sheep, a power. This may be in parallel, which means if you just equate this with a modern measurement, modern days measurement, what we normally use it now, as a measurement units is a megawatt, kilowatt, and watts. Megawatt is a horsepower, and cow power is a kilowatt, and goat power is a batch. This 11th sloka says, when the sadhaka visualized to generate energy for sectionalizing the whole process, it has been decided to name them as a generation, substation, and transmission, then distribution and consumer installations. Even that details have been given here. Brahmanasya mukhamasid bahurajanna krataha urutatasya yadvesha padvayam shudro jayataha. Beautifully it is here. You can see in the network on this system, in important place like generation, highly qualified experienced engineers should be posted. This sloka gives who has to manage this. In this place like substation and transmissions, a qualified and experienced engineers should be posted. In a distribution, qualified and experienced technicians should be posted. In a consumer installation, hard-working, skilled workers and persons should be posted. That is why I say, Shodro Ajayataha. This also gives beautifully the different form of energies. Chandrama manaso jatastaksho suryo jayataha mukandrasyagnischa pranadvaya rajayataha. This, the energy can be generated from hydroelectric generation, which is uncertain because it depends on the rain. If rain is not there, you are not able to generate. Then solar, limited. In a rainy days, you may not get sufficient sun rays. Indira and thermal, which can be mainly relied upon energy, can also be generated from the atomic and wind also. Nabhya asidantacharim antarachim shirshishnodau samavartataha padya bhumirdashah shrotatra shrotra tattatha loka akalpayan. It is well known that energy engulfed in all the corners of the world, and then heaven is the a treasure of this energy. Where that is an ionosphere. See, antariksha, one ionosphere, as explained here earlier, the lithosphere and ionosphere, I have mentioned about it, as explained earlier in the sloka 3. 3/4 of the unused energy is being deposited in the heaven. That is as a backup. This energy can be collected from this ionosphere for the focus point of a replica of the sky and harnessed. What is that replica? That modern day we use antenna. सप्तास्यान् परधियस्त्रिहि सप्तसमीरक्रतः देवाय तन्माना अबद्धन पुरुषात्मशुम्। दिस एनर्जी कैन बी जनरेटेड इन 7 फेजेस एंड एक्स्ट्रा हाई वोल्टेज विल बी टू द ट्यून ऑफ 7 × 21 एंड दिस कैन बी कंट्रोल्ड इन अ गैजेट विद 10 कंपार्टमेंट एंड 10 मेजर्स एज एक्सप्लेन अर्लियर इन श्लोक 1। जस्ट यू सी हाउ द वोल्टेज व्हाट कुड इन द ट्यून ऑफ 7 × 21 7 पावर ऑफ 21 imagine what could be value of that yadnena
majaganta devastani dharmani pradamannasan deha nakam mahimana san sachanta yatra purte sadhya santi devah।
meaning of this, those sadhakas who can generate this energy from the heaven without involving in any methods of generation, but strictly following the famed dictates as stipulated for obtaining such omnipotent energy, by understanding the secrets of such a omnipotent energy, will become the most respected person and enjoy all heavenly pleasures. This is what the layout Satish Chandra has come out from the secret interpretation of Purusha Sukta, and which he termed as Agragami nature's electricity generating system. Electricity flow of electron under the pressure from two different air potentials. That is, from that, what is the methods of generation? In Vedic concept, he says, Chandra, Surya, Indra, Agni, Prana, and Vayu. This is the Vedic concept. Equivalent of that, I hope you are able to see this picture. Equivalent of that is, existing one is Chandra, is a hydroelectric. It depends on the rain. Surya is a solar, is a costly right now. And also it is non-dependable because it depends on the intensity of, you know, solar rays you get. If it's cloudy, you will not get it. Indra indicates 2-1, that's a chemical. One is MHD, that is very important now for further research here. Then is another one is a battery. Next is Agni. Agni means thermal. Thermal, there are 2-1. One is petroleum products. There is also non-availability, and at one time all the you may exhaust. It's an exhaustible source of energy. And there is a coal. This is also not available. As it is, we are feeling the shortage of coal for thermal power station. Prana is atomic. Yes, very good. Non-pollution, but hazardous and costly. Safety issues are very important here. Then Vayu is windmill, depending on, once again, wind direction, wind velocity, what is available at respective places. So, what is one which further has been taken by him is the Indra, that is MHD. Here, MHD is the artificial process of electrode, that is creating basically a plasma, that is the positive charges creating, that is part plasma. And plasma is nothing but electromagnetic force. Ultimately, it becomes ionic charge particles, becomes electricity, can be converted into electricity. The another one, that is by, of course, this is generated by using the battery. And another one is MHD, which is natural process of obtaining the plasma electricity. What is this natural process of obtaining the plasma electricity? This is what is the ionosphere. There are charged particles. There's plasma available there, and that you have to bring it to the earth, develop a device to bring it, then subsequently to manage that enormous energy, what you obtain, and distribution. That is something which technology S. Satish Chandra has developed as a flow diagram which shows there. And here on the left side, he has given typically how the plasma is getting generated by chemical salt and electrical solution and electrolyte solution like what normally using. So then he has come to the tantra. Tantra is technology, techniques. How do you do it? He has decoded, worked out whole, you know, center, what you can see is the electrode, then whole antenna kind of a thing, you know, like a replica of the sky, and to collect those charged particles, then you collect it, that has to be, then he has worked out the dimensions also, what kind of dimensions system has to be there in the yantra. Then he has come out with, if such kind of high energy is brought to the earth, that means it creates a tremendous amount of heat. So what should have a cooling system? What kind of a water circulation you should have? What kind of cooling system should have? All those details he has worked out based on that. So he gives the gist of the yantra. Electronics, that the charged particles, which is available in abundance in Shishno. That's what Sukta says, Shishno. What is Shishno means? Shishno indicated in the Purushutta means, isn't that is an ionosphere. Shishno is equivalent, the interpretation is ionosphere. Ionosphere has to be collected by the replica of Antariksha, that is like a dish antenna. And Antariksha will be moving along the Shishno, moving along the Shishno. The electrons, that is charges, thus focused at Nabi. Nabi is a focus point. Has to be collected in a chamber called a prana. The electrons, that is charged particles, thus collected has to be passed through the chamber called vayu, which may be containing air or a gases. Here, the vacant cells of electrons will be absorbed atoms from the gases or air and becomes ions. Both electron charges and ions are to be blended to create a plasma ultimately. So then the plasma thus created has to pass through the chamber called Indra, which is the typical present days of a level nozzle, and pass through the Agni, which is having a strong magnetic field, that is electromagnetic force. And electrode are to be housed in the Agni itself. So this charge is to be collected in 1 to 7 phases. Can be single phase to the 7, single phase, 2 phase, 3 phase, 4 phase, like that, 7 phases can be collected. Charges thus collected will have to pass through the chamber called a Surya, which is similar to a substation and is having a circuit breakers. Then pass on to the load circuits. The whole system is to be cooled down by utilizing the water in the chamber called a chandra. That is similar to that, a cooling towers. How beautifully it has been brought out. It has composed of 45 yantras with 23,490 connections as a whole, out of which a 13,365 from the inside and 10,125 connections are outside, and about 225 coatings are to be made and when it is connected to the master control units having a 29,565 memories and activated, it starts collecting the Anga, that is heaven. That is, in other words, we call it, in technical terminology, we call it ionosphere. Without either generating station, transmission or disbursement distribution network, 225 alpha bits relates to yantra, 297 to tantra, and remaining 135 alpha bits is towards the excellence of a grammar. See how he has decoded total number of alpha bits used in this Purusha Sukta. This explains a special type of radar system, ultrasonic sound system, breathing system, automatic make of the break and contact system, superconductors, cooling towers for cooling systems, excellence and expertise that our ancestors possessed since millions of years in the practical usage of the principles of the magnetohydrodynamics to generate, that is MHD, magnetohydrodynamics to generate electricity, which has come to existence in the modern science since 1940 only. Before that, it's thousands of years our ancestors were using this electricity invented by the Carl Hortz, and that's the modern times here. This knowledge of our ancestors are undoubtedly far ahead of our modern science, no doubt. Mr. Sasi Chandra has developed Agragami static alternator also. That is, one, I told you there are two concepts, two yantras which have been, systems have been developed. One is static alternator concept, another is charged particles springing from the ionosphere directly wherever you want and have abundant electricity locally there. So now let's come to the another concept of static alternator for generating electricity based on this. Also done interpretation is done based on the Purusha. Again, earlier I have explained that. Of course, he has obtained the patent for that. And brief description of this static alternator is as follows. Existing alternator of rotating machine, which converts the mechanical energy into electrical energy. Hence, alternator should be mechanically coupled to prime mover. The must mechanically coupled to prime mover. Prime mover has to drive alternator. New method of static alternator for generation of electrical power consists of two units. First unit is a common runner, and the second unit consists of four or any number of static alternator depending on how many times you want to multiply. See, you can see in the picture there. That how simple, how compact it is, and that is yantra, that is static alternator there. The common, which Satish Chandra is explaining, the how the static alternator is works there in the picture. Common runner and static alternators are mechanically isolated from each other and are magnetically coupled. See, this is the difference between the a modern concept and a ancient Vedic science concept. In modern concept, we mechanically coupled. When you take a motor, for example, diesel engine, see the diesel generator, diesel engine is shaft is directly coupled to the generator shaft mechanically, making coupling and coupled together nuts and bolts. That's how the power getting transmitted. But because of the coupling, what happens is there's a loss of energy. We don't get even equivalent to the what a diesel engine generates power, we don't get that. You get less than that by the electricity. Here, it is coupled with a magnetically coupled. Just by rotating the common runner, all the static alternators generate electrical power. Just by rotating one common runner, which is not rho, we'll have this kind of a common runner. Any generator, you see the winding there, it each one will have separate only. Here it is a common. So with one common runner, whatever number you want to multiply it, you introduce the static alternator to the static thing there. Then it will start generating the power. The common runner may be rotating by means of a diesel engine or water turbine or steam turbine or electrical motor or manually rotating devices, or it may be attached to any rotating wheel. If there is no power, one can rotate by hand or by horse. Very simple in construction and installation, very economical method of power generation. As an alternatory static machine, rotation losses are absent. This method of power generation gives a constant and reliable supply. It can be manufactured to any required capacity, either single phase or three phase. For the given capacity, the output is approximately three times the given value of the input, but the loss of conservation energy will not be violated. That's absolutely if it is. If this method of generation of electrical power is implemented, the existing problem of power crisis may be completely solved. Mr. Satish Chandra also brought out in his book that Western scientist who has been awarded US patent dated August 11, 1987 has substantiated his claim of electricity generation by various science. This I have also obtained copy of this patent what this scientist has got, which is winning for the, ultimately he got a Nobel Prize for that. It's virtually reinventing the wheel, what a Vedic scientist had done it exactly, not fully, some bit of work what he did it, and he got a Nobel Prize for that. That is in 1970, Dr. Alphavan has also substantiated his claim about the very concept about the availability of the electric current in solar wind, that is in ionosphere. Even though the Nobel Prize has been awarded to him in a different context, thus strengthen the claim of Mr. Satish Chandra with a reference to the present day scientific approval also. So let me little bit explain what this Nobel Prize winning scientist has done it. As you know, in America, in northern poles, all the heavy snow will be there all the time, no electricity. Whereas US Army has to be there to protect their borders. So, that long time people were looking for how to generate electricity. But the army had experienced once a while two charged particles will drop to the earth. It was so heavy, it's like a big fire. It just, and that keep on happening frequently. This scientist, what he has done it, he understood what it is that. There's nothing but from where the charge particles are coming to the earth. He realized that it is from the ionosphere. Because of northern pole, which is a strategic place for, you know, losing that from the ionosphere and falling into the earth, he developed a technology to capture those bits and pieces of the fallen charged particles, not that abundant stream of particles. He has not brought that abundant stream of particles, charged particles from the ionosphere. Whatever falls on the earth, he found a mechanism, he found a technology, he found a solution and created that this way it can be captured. When you captured it, you can generate out of that electricity and store it and make available to those armed forces. See, one way good, it's difficult to validate the concept of what Inner Purushottam says, building such kind of infrastructure and validating that, whatever he says, but this Nobel Prize winning scientist exactly done what Purushottam says, that there is an abundant charged particles available there. And he generated a system. He developed a system by whenever that falls on the earth, from that he can generate electricity. So it's nothing but indirectly the proof of concept to what Mr. Satish Chandra is advocating. See, this is what US patent, this is how he describes that, and this is how the charged particles falls on that, this is how he invented the coils from there, where he wanted to collect it. Probably, I'm not sure, the similar way Tesla must have been thought of his invention, and they called it the Tesla coil for bringing those inert charged particles from the ionosphere. But anyhow, this one of the patent, what it shows is, it is a Vedic science concept is a reality. MHD stands for magnetohedrodynamics, the science of the flow of fluids through the magnetic field. Science of the flow of fluids through the magnetic field. It also referred to as a magnetoplasma dynamics, MPD, magnetogas dynamics, called MGD. Since the magnetic field acts only on electrically charged particles, fluid here must be electrically conducting. This differentiates MHD from the aerohydrodynamics. That's what is the beauty of that. MHD is a new and promising source of power for power-hungry world. The ever-increasing demands from the industries have prompted scientists look for a cheaper and more efficient means of generating power. For this reason, the direct energy conversion process are becoming increasingly important out of many processes like fusion reactor, thermionic converters, etc. And MHD has received most attention and is the nearest to commercial utilization. Accordingly to Faraday's laws, where wires carrying a current, if moved in a magnetic field, develops induced EMF in them. Same results can be obtained directly by the flow of conducting gas or a liquid at a high temperature across the magnetic field. See, there is no moving part here. The gas or a fluid is made conductive by seeding it with some chemical salts. The salts split up into their basic constituents of charged particles like electrons and ions to form a stream of plasma, and this is the principle of MHD power generation. Gas or fluid used is the fuel gas produced by the burning coal, oil or gas, and air in a combustor, or an inert gas like a helium or a neon, or a liquid metal like lithium. So charged particles like electrons or ions moving in a directional normal to the magnetic field experience a force, a mutually perpendicular to the direction normal to the magnetic field, experience a force mutually perpendicular to the direction of motion as well as a magnetic field itself. This is the law of magnetic induction discovered by the Michael Faraday in the early 19th century. Force thus acting on a stream of positively and negatively charged particles pulls them apart, which sets up an electromotive force that we call it EMF. Thus, this induced EMF is given by E is equal to V into B, where V is the fluid velocity and B is the magnetic field at right angles to it. The above relation between E, V and B is the well-known Hall effect observed in solids and liquids and also in a gases under the suitable conditions. By locating electrodes at a proper places in the stream of flow, power can be extracted from this induced EMF. The power output P per unit volume from such a system is given by P is equal to rho V square into K, that 1 minus L, where rho is the electrical conductivity of the gas, that is the plasma, and K is the load factor, which is the measure of the drop in EMF, and E is a due to flow of current through the circuit. Hence, K is the ratio of a closed circuit voltage to open circuit voltage. The recommended value of K is of the order of half. The above expression for power forwards that MHD power system should employ a highly conducting gas flow across a strong magnetic field at a high velocity. See, this is of the conceptualized layout from getting energy from the ionosphere, then it is transmitting it here, then it's on generator, then it goes on the system, how the distribution system and all that, which we normally adopt in the current days. So I would like to conclude here, but because it has taken a lot of time, I would like to conclude here. Probably next another two case studies I will take the subsequent lecture. Here, question arises: such a wonderful technology, which is decoded, why it is not brought into usage? This question. Yes, Satish Chandra is trying very hard, past 2 decades. There are long, so many legal issues with involved in this process to bring this ancient science to make it a reality, and India should have abundant electricity. One is tremendous amount of investment which is required, and government approvals which are required to set up this kind of a thing. That's one aspect. Second is aspect of it. Of course, the element of risk is always there when the high investment you make it, because concept into the a product, there are a lot of uncertainties always will be there in any development phase. But here, initially, a static alternator system, no problem. There are a few here and there issues of mechanical integrity and things like that, but those are always, I think you must have come over all those issues. Now it must be in a stage of production. But when it comes to the bringing charged particles from the ionosphere, in that system, which is the one more promising than the static alternator, because that is an abundant energy available there. Anywhere, no transmission system, no transmission losses. For that, though he has developed a prototype, but when I met him at that point of time, he had apprehension for doing the testing, because when for testing he needs a government permission. His apprehension was when that electrical charge particles are brought to earth, so the antenna kind of a things here, then what happens is it intercept all the communication channels, systems, including military intelligence across the globe. It intercepts there, then that may create chaos, and then respective governments can across the globe can take action, legal action on him. This was his apprehension. For that, about 2 decades back, or as maybe he was trying in the previous regime of the central government, he was trying to get the approval for testing it. If the government gives an approval, it's safe, because the government will take care of the any global crisis. But unfortunately, no government in the past gave permission to him to do this. During that time, but I had my own doubt, do we require this kind of permission? Then I interacted with him by taking one of my friend, he's a program director in ISRO and dealing with this kind of thing, communication systems, a Padma Shri Award V.R. Katti. We both went there and discussed with him and looked at his system, then he was the opinion that it is not required. Because in satellite communication, many of such signals are being transmitted from there to the earth. So it is not required. That was his opinion. But here he had his own attention because that communication system is different. Here, enormous amount of heat, enormous amount of energy, which is the magnitude is very high here. So that was an apprehension. And subsequently, of course, I was not in touch with him. But what I understand with the recent past that he has formed a corporate company for the manufacture of this printer product, and Modi government had come to his support in Gujarat. They have given him a land to set up a manufacturing unit. And globally, many key investors have joined because this requires enormous amount of investment, joined hands, including a Muslim country like Malaysia, have joined hands and made an investment. Of course, that must be many challenges. It is not that easy, this technology. One is handling of this technology is not that easy. Management system, management challenges itself is enormous. That may be many teething problems which currently may be going on. But I'm sure it's a matter of time. All those will be overcome and product become reality. If that reality becomes once again, India will become Vishwaguru for the energy, which was there. India was a Vishwaguru in the past, in a philosophical aspect of it, but also in technology aspect of it, of course, which were not exposed earlier. But now, the Vishwaguru becomes also in energy systems. So let us look forward. All of us will wish that becomes a reality in the days to come, and you will get all the necessary support, approval, all kind of helps to make it this reality, and look forward for the day to come. So I will stop the presentation of this case study because it took a long time. So I will present next two case studies in the subsequent lecture. So let me thank you for the patience hearing. This time I have exceeded the time limit which was earmarked for this. I thought of stopping in between, but then continuity will be lost. So therefore, I continued till the explanation on the detailed explanation on this case study is completed. So you can always, if you have got time constraint, you can always keep on looking for it or seeing for it at your own bandwidth of time. Thank you for your patience for listening to this. Now all this credit should go to great engineer who dedicated himself, his life for re-engineering into this product, Mr. Satish Chandra. He has set up, when I'd interacted, he set up a campus. He had his campus at Jaipur, behind the Jaipur airport. Then subsequently, he set up a larger campus at Yelahanka. There also, I had been once. So basically, through the model of education institutions, he's trying to do this kind of research work. It's something great. We must salute for his dedicated effort to bring, re-engineering this ancient lost science to make it as a reality. Thank you very much for listening to this. Look forward to meet you in the next Sunday. Thank you very much.